something if you do want to do is you can pull those into two separate text amendments. You're more than welcome to do that. You can regulate home occupations or have primary caregivers be their own standalone use. How it's been drafted and I've been directed is that it would be under that home occupation umbrella. We added an additional sentence to clarify the activity that is associated with it. It helps with the other provision we made where we added services. So it kind of all end is a better definition for what we intended on, not just products of a retail situation, but also a service like a tax accounting type situation. Home occupations being the primary focus is a single family dwelling unit, and then incidentally next to that, you have some type of other activity that's going on the property. We are proposing still to add the primary caregiver definition for clarity. This does not include any recreational components. So through the Recreational Act, there are different things that were approved as far as growing and consumption. That's not part of this regulation. Primary caregivers are specifically named, and they have to go through a licensing process through LARA. So that's something that pulls them out separate from those who are using it otherwise under the Recreational Act. So the first set under A is for all home occupations. So you have your type 1, which is your permitted use confined to the dwelling unit, rather than your type 2, which is generally a more intense operation and can be expanded into the detached accessory building. Something that we changed from the last version that you saw was to have it so then primary caregivers, instead of being stuck under the type 2 classification, they can now be either a type 1 or a type 2, depending upon the primary caregiver's approach. So they can choose to be a type 1, which is a permitted use, generally would be reviewed administratively, and that would be permitted, it would be confined to the dwelling unit, as opposed to then, if they would like to be in the detached accessory building, that would be a type 2, a special land use requires a public hearing, oversight by the Planning Commission. So depending upon their model, they would be able to choose one or the other. Now that's your discretion to regulate in that capacity. But as a quick refresh, for all home occupations, this is typically your hair salon that you use as a room or their front room, or a fountain, different things of that nature. So we have sign limitations. We help clarify as far as no sales of different goods are conducted at the home. No traffic shall be generated that's uncustomary to a residential neighborhood. We want to make sure that we're maintaining different performance standards to not encourage any nuisances associated with neighboring properties. Primary caregivers are limited to not more than one employee not residing at the home. So they can have one that's lived somewhere else, but again, the customary idea is that the resident is the one holding the permit and therefore is the one that is doing the operation of the business. Things that were suggested to be added in addition include hours of operation. So this would essentially intend on when customers would be potentially coming by, in which they would be engaging in the business, having appointments. You would be doing, if it's an auto body repair shop out of somebody's garage, there are some small time ones that I've seen different townships do, that you wouldn't want it to exceed 9 o'clock working on cars or things of that nature. And then the last addition is clarification that applicants should provide a plot plan. So that's a lower level of detail as opposed to a formal site plan submission. So generally a plot plan is something you can take an aerial and say, this is the home, this is this, and this is what I'm going to do there. So it's less requirements as far as what needs to be provided, and then a floor plan as part of their application. The next one is talking about specific requirements for primary caregivers. And again, as I previously mentioned, a big change from the last version that you saw is that it was, now they can be a type 1 or a type 2 home occupation. So some standard language regarding making sure that they're compliant with the Michigan Medical Marijuana Act, MMMA, as was referred to earlier, and other requirements associated with the Michigan Regulation and Taxation of Marijuana Act. Something that you see in the draft in front of you, you can see in number 2 on the screen, is that it went from 5 acres to 2 acres, and then it cannot be located a condominium master plan, platted subdivision, or a land unit development. So that is something that can can stay there, can be moved from one box to a different box if we were, wanted to tailor that. I believe that's why the highlight is yellow. Number three talks about the growing location for primary caregivers shall be provided in an enclosed locked facility, similar to the last language. A new requirement that was added was conducting the primary caregiver shall not exceed a installation of 200 amp service. That is something that's now very popular amongst communities to regulate. There's a variety of different approaches communities have taken associated with that. Typically, the reason you see 200 amp service being utilized is because that's generally customary for single family residential homes. So that's why that general number is used. And you will see a lot more drafts current day that have some type of amperage concern associated with it. Number five talks about the holder of the primary license shall renew their permit on an annual basis from the time that it is granted. Six was maintained. This is an attempt to also protect primary caregivers' information so they're not something that's subject to a Freedom of Information Act or FOIA request to ensure that their information isn't being distributed amongst the public upon request. Seven was modified, talking about different township officials, those different examples, to conduct those different inspections on the property and that home occupation. We tried to tailor it a little bit more so it's more clear when inspections are appropriate. So it's first when it's established, part of the annual renewal process, and if there are complaints. Typically, as part of a zoning ordinance violation, that's not something that they can go and knock on or enter into the building without the appropriate authority. That's something that they can stand from the property line, generally speaking, look into the property and say, these are the different concerns. It's very, very common that your zoning administrator, whoever's conducting this inspection, would definitely have the property owner either with them or at least a representative from their organization with them. Again, to make sure that it's all straightforward regarding what the complaint was, what are the different complaints, if there is anything, can that be easily amended on that visit trip. So section C talks specifically about type 1 home occupation. So again, those are the permitted uses. Those are by right. Those are generally processed as a administrative action. We provided potentially three other options associated with determining the calculation. So the original does not include the basement as part of the floor area calculation. So option one is that the residential floor area shall include all floor area within the dwelling, including the basement. And as much as the basement area has a ceiling of a height of at least 7 feet in that basement area. Option two is the residential floor area shall be include the basement area. However, the basement floor area used in the home occupation shall not be included in the 25% limit. And then option three is the residential floor area shall not include the basement floor area. And then on our last page, number two, if the use of the primary caregiver shall, this is a newer requirement as well, is that you have to provide delivery services. So the intent to not necessarily have the qualified patients specifically come to those individual homes. That is something that you'll see that some communities are now starting to do. That's relatively new to see with different regulations. And then lastly, the modifications we made was to the type 2 home occupation, a slightly different section because it is a special land use. We modified the 375 square feet to be 650 square feet, or the 25%, whichever is greater. We did not change the commercial vehicle requirement of 1, and then this table was revised as part of your table of uses. Type 1 home occupation is permitted, and then your type 2 is a non-discretionary